just 6:50, and this is the meeting of the City Council Committee on City Services. And, thank you. I will note that all members are present. That is Councilor Bidwell, Councilor Ryan O'Donnell, Councilor LaBarge, and myself, Councilor Maureen. So, I see that there is no public comment for this meeting, and I will first just ask if there is a motion to approve the minutes.
Move to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any additions, corrections, none? Okay. Then, welcome tonight, thank you, and we have a departmental presentation from the Veterans Services and Veterans Council.
And I would go ahead and let the Veterans Council go first, they've been sitting here a while.
I just want to announce also too, please, that Bradley Bay cannot be here this evening, and he's going to come in because he is the president of the Veterans Council.
Nor is Jerry Clark.
Jerry Clark, right, he's just had some surgery.
We're down two.
How many copies of this?
Oh, great.
Everybody.
I'll go through the program for you.
Yeah, I'll grab it.
Give everybody a copy.
We have 10 annual events as the Veterans Council. The first being this weekend, the St. Patrick's Day Parade. We put our Jeep, and the Jeep will also have the Bog Warrior. If any of you have been through Bay State Riverside Drive, you see in front of the Legion, the Warrior with the helmet will be in the trailer for the parade. It'll also be in the parade Memorial Day, and it leaves. So March is on the 19th. Leeds Memorial Day dedication will be Sunday, May 28th at 1 o'clock. Our Memorial Day parade is our annual parade in Florence. The speaker is to be determined. In June, we do a flag day with a symbolized flag retirement. And our flag retirement ceremony, which is kind of private, we have a couple of troops of Boy Scouts that help us, and we just burn the flags. In August, we have Purple Heart Day, August 7th. October, we have the Polish Heritage Parade on October 9th. And we have the Veterans Day Breakfast, which is free to city veterans. And that will be on November 4th at the Elks Lodge. And we have the Veterans Day Parade on November 11th. And our last event of the year, which is usually the coldest, is Pearl Harbor Day at the bridge on December 7th. And I don't believe in the valley here that we have only one Pearl Harbor survivor left, if I'm correct. Because Joe Malesko just...
Joe passed.
Joe just passed.
Just passed. And there's only one more, and he's from
Granby.
Granby. And that's the last one of the Pearl Harbor veterans.
And they're all in there. I mean, think about it, 1941. And they're all in their mid-90s.
Well, when you look at Vietnam veterans, they're in their 70s.
That's true.
You know?
I'd like to ask you, in regards to the Memorial Day Parade up in Florence.
Florence, yeah.
May 29th, at what time? What does that time?
The parade kicks off at 10 o'clock. The ceremony in the cemetery is at 11.
Unless you want to go to all the other ceremonies. That starts real early.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
And also in June on Flag Day, on that ceremony to be announced, June 14th.
Well, that's...
That's the burning of the flag at the Elk. What time though?
June 14th is not the date. June 14th is Flag Day, but we usually do it on a Sunday. because we find that doing it on a weekday, we don't get the participation. So it will be a Sunday, but the actual flag day is June 14th.
But isn't that the day when we work with the Elks?
Yeah.
No.
No, June 18th, I think is the day we're doing the ceremony.
I think it's the 10th, Steve, but I'm not positive.
Well, we usually do it on a Sunday, right?
Yeah. Is the 10th a Saturday?
Yeah, so the Sunday, the 11th, or the 18th.
Well, it will either be the 11th or the 18th, and we haven't firmed that up with the Elks, so.
Okay.
We will announce it. Okay?
That's.
And Pearl Harbor Day always takes place with the raising of the flag in the morning out here in front of Memorial Hall.
What time in the morning?
I'll tell you after our March meeting.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
And we usually post these things on both our Facebook and our department website. So you can find it on there if people don't see it anywhere else, but.
Usually there's an ad in the paper for it, too.
You all should have received your invitation to the Memorial Day Parade.
They're sitting in their mailboxes.
They're in the mailboxes.
We'll get them Thursday.
Yeah.
The city council meeting. Thank you for that.
We love your participation.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Any other questions, Mary?
May I ask a question?
Please.
Sure.
I mean, what you do is so important to the city. I'm wondering, do you have any sense of participation? Do you find greater numbers of people showing up to these events, new people from the community coming in? Do you have any sense of that over the years?
Last year at Memorial Day was probably the biggest turnout I've seen in the 12 to 14 years that I've been on the council.
That was great.
And November, Veterans Day, was a good turnout, but.
Very little advertising.
Very little, you know, it, years ago, it was always held in the front of Memorial Hall. And sitting there in one of those nice cold metal chairs,
right,
and watching a little girl almost get clipped by a car.
Oh, God.
I made the motion 4 years ago that we move the ceremony into Pulaski Park.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And since then, we've done in Pulaski Park, and the only thing that's happened out in front by the memorial is the firing squad. So
right. Okay.
It's a lot safer, and of course with the park now, it's a lot nicer.
Yep, absolutely. Mm-hmm.
So that's why that move ever transpired,
right,
is because
makes sense.
I certainly didn't want to see a little kid get hit by a car, you know?
And participation has moved up since then.
Yeah, it has.
It actually even helped with the Polish Heritage Parade, mm-hmm, because we're further back in the park. I mean, when you're either in front of Memorial Hall or in the old park, they wanted to be right near the monument, which meant everybody was up close.
Right.
Can't hear anything, right, with the, so you have people all over the place.
Right.
And some would just say, you know, this, I can't hear, it's,
yeah,
not worth it.
Right,
and it would,
right,
leave,
right.
So,
the world's better now. Yeah.
The sound system at Memorial Day is also, thanks to Tommy Pease, getting a extra loud system so that people actually at the fence can actually hear. We try to bring people in, but it used to be where people would kind of be there, they'd watch a little bit, and then they'd all leave because they couldn't hear anything.
Right, sure.
So we get the sound to travel a lot further. So.
And one of the other things that we've done in the last few years is we've set out chairs in there. There's some of us, you know, can't stand too long. And there's a lot of us at that age group that are, you know, our veterans, and
just got to keep the kids out of it.
Yeah.
But yeah, so
it's.
And Memorial Day Parade in Florence has been, I just can't believe it's 3-4 deep. I just get such a kick out of everybody that watches as we go through.
And it's amazing because you have so many families throughout our city that either the daughters or the husbands or whatever have served our country, like our family. And it's like you're there for respect for everybody who has served our country, no matter if they have passed away or they're still alive. I think the Memorial Day parade is just, it's unbelievable.
Well, Memorial Day, if you look at it, Memorial Day is to honor our deceased. Veterans Day is to honor the living veterans. And that is the way it's always been.
And look what's happening, though. I wish my husband was here to talk. Here you talk today about, you know, people in their 70s and so forth like that. And I think, Nick, you've heard my husband say that. Many of your VFWs and all that, all your older ones are passing away. And it's trying to get the new ones in.
They try.
I know, exactly. It's a problem.
It's very hard.
We had, the council had that big event in the park in summer of 15. And I mean, it was a tremendous amount of work that went into it. You know, free food and all kinds of things. And the object of it, and had all the veterans organizations, and the object of it was to see if we could get those men and women that served the Desert Storm and Iraq and Afghanistan, and, you know, to swell the numbers, the world, you know, the different veterans clubs, the VFW, American Legion, or and they just, you know, it's a tough position.
It's a tough call.
It's a tough call. You know, they served their country, they did their time, and the whole, and there's quite a group in our valley. And they're not interested in, you know.
You look at the average age of your Veterans Council, and it's in the 70s.
They're all 39. But anyway.
It's a different spirit. It is.
The breakfast that Tim co-chaired with Tom Pease last November was an overwhelming success. God, there's what, close to 200?
Where was it?
It was at the Elks, yeah. You know, vets were free. You know, we were wondering,
packed.
Blew us away. Vets were free, and, you know, their spouse or friend or whatever, they had a $10 fee, and we're going to repeat that performance again this year. That was, was a great event. Wish we had a place that held more people.
Thank you for everything that you're doing for the city.
That was well attended.
Involved.
The turnout at the breakfast was probably, it was remarkable. When you say, when they first started the breakfast at the senior center, if we could get 45 or 50 people, we thought we had a crowd. And it really started when we did the Purple Heart ceremony down there. That was the start, and that was the last time we could hold it down there because the hall couldn't hold anymore. And we went to Smith School for a couple of years, and then the Elks graciously, they waived the hall fees and everything for us, so they've done a lot for the community, the Elks have. And, their adoptive veteran program at the VA, and the veterans help, and so there's a lot to be said for the community.
And the city also. I think the city has helped out the Veterans Council.
Yes, you have.
No question.
And they won't let me drive the Jeep, but that's okay.
Insurance.
Yeah. It's in the
you can drive it to Hoyer Sunday. I think it's going to get towed down on a flatbed. Yeah.
Well, we thank you.
You're more than welcome. If you don't have any other questions, we will leave. Thank you, folks.
Thank you for coming.
Thanks very much.
Pleasure. Appreciate it. Gentlemen, ladies, God bless America. Steve is loaded for a bear.
Steve has got it.
Yeah,
he's got materials.
Well, I read the questions, so I prepped some of it ahead of time.
You ready? Are we ready to go?
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Good night, all.
Thank you very much.
Good night.
Happy St. Patrick's Day.
Happy St. Patrick's. And Nick, we'll see you at the country club.
No problem. Thank you, Mary Ann.
You're welcome.
Say hi to Rich.
Hi, Rich.
Oh, you're more than welcome.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brian. Good to see you.
Thanks, you too.
I guess you gotta go up this one. Wow, I slid.
So what I gave you on the front page is our budget and where it stands, and I just have to give you some particulars. It's hard because didn't want to make color copies, but as you look at all the line items that are there, some of them have asterisks next to them. Okay, if it has an asterisk next to it, it means that it's not just the city paying it. It means all 11 communities paying to that line item. If it's shaded a little gray, and you gotta squint to see that, I can tell you what they are: medical, dental, veterans benefits, burial, and medical, second to the last. Those are the items that the state reimburses the city of Northampton for at 75%. And then we only have a few at the bottom, and that's not even exact, but close. Ceremonial food and other veterans benefits, those are straight out of the city budget. However, under ceremonial, it's a little misleading because we buy our flags out of that. We buy them for the entire district, and we get all of the 75% back because we can buy the flags a lot cheaper if I get them for all 11 communities. So they pay in the beginning of the fiscal year, they pay in for their flags. They only pay 75% of what we're going to provide them. I'm sorry, they pay 25% of what the bill would be. City pays the other 75%, but then we get that all back to the state for all our flags. So that's where our items are. And some of the things, like the top one, office equipment, it says the amount spent is zero. That's only because our stuff gets taken out right at the end, because Central Services buys all that stuff, provides it to us, as well as the copier and all that. So at the end of the year, they yank all the money out. So that's why it looks like no money's been taken out, but it'll be taken out right before the end of the fiscal year, because they wait to see how much we spend and they just take it out. But we keep it at that rate because the other cities and towns, you know, they look at it and go, you don't even use that. Why are you giving it? Why are you making us pay into it? It's like, yeah, you gotta wait until all this stuff is taken out at the end of the year. So, and the training and seminars and stuff, we still have a couple more coming up, so that's not complete yet. And travel shows a high amount only because I am terrible about filling out reimbursement forms, because it's really, 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 really annoying, and I hate doing it. So I let it get too high, and then I have to do it all at once. But that's a lot less than what it shows. All that money will be gone, especially when we, Tom, who travels a lot of up into the hill towns, I do, for the most part, I'm in Amherst, Hadley, Northampton, Williamsburg, and then I go to the hill towns when they all have their budget meetings. So that's, I only go there once, twice a year, unless I'm covering for Tom's vacation. Then I might go a few more times, but most of that is his travel and he does all of that. And yeah, it looks like, for those who remember when I started 13 years ago, we had a budget way back then at $34,000 that we paid out in benefits, and as you now see, it's I think we budgeted 64 $640,000. So that's a lot more, and that was a growing thing. But it's actually gone down in the last few years. But this year, we're going to be real close. We might have to come back at the end of the year to just get a little bit more money. We may not have to. It depends. But we're starting to go back again. A lot of our World War II spouses, you know, the surviving spouses, have passed or have moved into nursing homes. So they come off the last several years. We've really seen a decline. But now the Vietnam veteran is, they were pointing out, are in their 70s. They have more health issues. They're not lasting as long. They're not living as long. So we're dealing with their spouses now. So our numbers are going back up. Or the ones that have chronic health problems. So we had a little lull, but it's going back. And of course, burial, you never know. There might be that coming in, and that'll be what we use for the remainder. If we still have that still there. I know one just passed and the application went in, so that's now only $6,000, but that's still half of what we budgeted. So we may not have to come back, we'll just use that money into the other one. But of course, you never know. So anybody have questions about my budget, where we are, where we're going?
So the burial, is that, to what extent do veterans get, I mean, is there a benefit for burial? Is it a full
payment? What happens is it's for indigent veterans. It's usually the veterans that are living in public housing, they have no savings, or even if they're up at the VA or at Soldier On, if they pass during that time, they usually don't have any savings. Most of them don't have any connection with their family anymore. So when they pass, Massachusetts has a law that if the funeral is $3,000 or less, we can pay up to $2,000 of that bill to have that person interred. Often we have them go to Agawam, or more often they go way up into Winchendon if they have no family or whatever. Have you ever been to the Agawam Cemetery?
No,
that's beautiful.
It is. I've been to Agawam, Winchendon, and Bourne. And Bourne is the national cemetery, and it's nice. But all the stones are flat. So you go to Agawam or Winchendon, and they're all upright, and they're all lined up. And when they do wreaths across America, it's unbelievable how those cemeteries look. The one up in Winchendon, which is huge, they're the only ones who will take pre-registration. Like, lots of people want to pre-register, get rid of all that stuff, take care of it. Agawam can't take it because they don't know if there'll be this space. Winchendon is huge and they've got plenty of space, but if you ever get a chance to go to either one of them, they're, for a state cemetery, it's pretty amazing. And the fact that it's perpetual care, you don't have to worry, you know, that's gonna happen. It's a pretty good deal.
And it is, it's absolutely beautiful in there. I mean, even when they have their services, mm-hmm. and they do have some big monuments in there, I've seen those.
Right.
Well, which ones I'm talking about, where the flagpoles are and that. Mm-hmm. But say, for instance, okay, your husband, whatever, okay, served our country, mm-hmm. his wife can go there.
Yep.
And if the son also lives at home with them, he can go there too.
If there is a child who's been disabled since the age of 18, which is the same as the people we can serve financially. So if somebody was born with a disability and they've been with their family until whatever, they can go into the Massachusetts cemeteries, number one. Number two, when the parents go, we can help them out financially. We put them on benefits if they've always been disabled. So they get treated the same way as the veteran or the veteran's spouse.
Well, I know of some cases where the sons live with the parents, father died, and then the mother died, right here in Northampton, and the son went there also. Mm-hmm. Because they lived at home with the parents, and it was not disabled.
You would have to have been a dependent of some sort, according to the law. But, yeah, so, I mean, it's a gorgeous cemetery.
It is.
And that money that we pay out to 2,000, under the same thing as everything else, we get 75% back. So if it costs 2,000 that we pay out, we get 1,500 back from the state.
I think it's amazing because you have to see it. It's like one funeral after another over there.
Both my parents are there, so.
Yeah, we had it just way out there in the street. It was like one after another.
Yeah.
Who maintains Agawam, who on behalf of the state, Agawam and Winchendon Cemetery?
It's through the Department of Veteran Services.
Yeah.
Yeah, that state department, all of those folks, it's in the state budget.
They're adequately funded for that?
Yes. There was a little bit of a problem, actually, not too long ago, within the last 2 years, where there was some tight budgeting, and so they weren't getting the stones done in time, and they were pulling out the old ones before they put in a new one. And the reason why, I don't really understand why they don't put a stone in that already has access for all the information.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what they do is if one went, they'd build the stone, and then if the other person went, they'd take out that stone and put in another one with both names on it, which wasn't the wisest side. I think they learned the lesson there, but they ended up a whole bunch of them that only had one thing. They were pulling them out, and yet there wasn't enough money to keep up with them. But that's worked out. And it's also, there's funding that comes from the VA as well. Not huge amounts, but it's, you know, if they're a veteran, the state cemeteries get some of the money comes from the VA, from the national. So
they do a good job keeping that cemetery up.
Steve, how do you feel in general about funding from the state and federal government this year in terms of all your work? Is it still too early to know?
As far as the state is concerned, they, you know, there's some ceremonial stuff they cut. The governor did some 9C cuts, right, on things like that and monuments. But for the actual needs of the veterans and their families, there was no cut. So that's been pretty consistent. The feds, who knows? I mean, it's
right.
It's been funded really well.
Mm-hmm.
There's talk that it's going to stay that well funded.
Mm-hmm.
We'll see. There's been a hiring freeze, which has caused a mess for the VAs here,
yeah,
because some people have gone on medical leave, maternity leave, and they can't even temporarily hire. There's just like a hiring freeze, so that's been frustrating.
Okay.
But
you.
For the state funding,
Okay.
The state funding, we've done well, and we're still getting our stuff back. So. So I included. So that was the budget, but then I was asked if what other services, and I just wanted to quickly, folks, remember a few years ago I got a grant from the state to include other communities, and they also gave me a bunch of money for outreach. That has been used, but one of the things it's been used on is this card that got developed by both myself and a woman who works for the VA homeless program, and then another person who works in the COC. And I got a couple of different types. Some of you might have three of them, and some of you only have two, because I ran out, or I didn't run out, I just grabbed the wrong ones. This one, this darker one, is in English, and it pretty much starts, and it says, you have a history of military service, yes or no. And it goes through all the things. Well, are you eligible for VA healthcare? It says who to contact. This is if you are homeless or at risk of homelessness. So it asks you to do that. If you don't know about that, you can call me at the Veteran Service Office. But the darker card uses a state and a state number. And then if that doesn't work, if you're not eligible for My Benefits through Chapter 115, the last number three is how to use SSVF. And in Western Massachusetts, we have two providers of that program, both Soldier On and Vet Inc. SSVF stands for Supportive Service for Veteran Families. And that can be a family of one, just an individual veteran, or it can be the whole family. We've had grandfathers be the veteran, but because he is responsible for either his children or his grandchildren, or her grandchildren, they are eligible for that monies. And it's, those are federal monies, the one in the middle, number two is state money. This lighter colored one is if you're in my district, because then it's got my office phone number. We don't do that one statewide, because, or even Western Mass, because Becky would kill me. And then there's one that's in Spanish. So that's what we did with these, with the outreach money, and it was to make sure our fight to end veterans homelessness, this makes it really easy. These go to all the libraries in Western Mass. I don't do the other part of Massachusetts, because these are specific for, other than the VA, the other two things are specific for kind of Western Mass, how to reach them. But police have them, libraries have them, any place where hospitals, elder social workers have them, other kind of social workers, all the shelters have these cards. And it's just to find out if the person might be, and it asks the question, do you have a history of military service, rather than, are you a veteran? Because that one all depends on who you ask. I have Korean War veterans say, I was never shot. I was shot at, but I was never shot. So I'm not a veteran. And I have others that, well, I served, I was in basic, and you didn't do anything else. So there's a whole array of how people look at, so we don't ask the question. It's pretty much, do you have a history of military service? And if they do answer yes, then we try to figure it out from there, and they get passed around. And the other sheet I included was just a breakdown. This is under Mass General Law. It says, until July 1st, these numbers are correct. If you have less than that, you could be eligible for either cash assistance, medical payment assistance, food assistance, whatever. And on the other side, we put down the Massachusetts Veterans Bill of Rights that say, because lots of times you'll have a veteran go into an office, not ours, but they'll go into offices. Some of the communities we used to, before we did, and they'd go in and say, I wanted to apply for it, and they go, sorry, we're out of money, or no, you're not eligible, without taking their application. So I make sure that it says you have a right, no matter what city or town in Massachusetts you go to, you have a right to have your application taken and get a decision in writing. It's really hard to get veterans to demand that, but that's their rights, and other communities won't do the right thing if you don't make them do it. But a lot of them do the right thing. So, and Northampton still leads. We have the largest caseload per capita in the state of Massachusetts. Yeah. We serve anywhere from 150 to 170 on any given month.
And that's because we have the VA hospital.
We have the VA hospital, we have Soldier On. Because we have the public housing, what's unique for Northampton and most of the other places in the state is when there's a VA hospital there and somebody gets, say, the non-service connected pension, which means either they're pretty low income and all their Social Security is going to be either small or their SSI is going to be small, the VA provides additional monies if they're disabled. If they're over the age of 65, they also can get that. Combined with both benefits, still only like $170 something. I mean, excuse me, $1,070. It's now $1,080 a month, which doesn't give you a whole lot of options. That's not a lot of money. If they have a disability, they don't want to get very far from the VA because that's their healthcare provider. You know, they don't have other insurances, so they stay local. So Northampton has a lot of veterans that when they've been determined to be disabled, or if they have the HUD-VASH vouchers, they want to live around here, so it keeps us busy. We have more people because the VA hospital is right there, and they can just get on a bus and go, rather than living, you know, 40 miles away and trying to get there. So that's why we have such a large caseload between those three issues. So that's that. The other things I just wanted to quickly cover. we work really close with the VA and all the outreach things that we do. And the latest was just last weekend, we had the Winter Music Fest, which was a fundraiser for Homeward Vets, but it was just all over the city. You know, it was for anybody who wanted to come. It wasn't a veterans concert. It was for anybody. And we were hoping that some veterans would just come, and they got to go in for free. The VA enrolled, I think, three to five people, which is good. And we found others that were eligible for our benefits that we also connect them up with. So, and the reason we've kind of gone that way is we used to do big projects down in Springfield. There used to be stand-downs. There still are, but we did a couple of years where we did a veterans expo trying to, you know, come find out what your benefits are. Veterans don't want to come. They're not going to come to these, especially the younger ones. Like they were saying, you can't get them to come into clubs. They're come home, they're adjusting. If they have a family, they're raising their family. They're not running around trying to find all this stuff out. And they definitely don't go to veteran specific things like they used to, I guess. Mm-hmm. So at the Big E, it was started several years ago, the VA paid to have space. And last year they enrolled the most amount of veterans that they could, because everybody goes and then you pick out the veterans. We did, for the first time last year, we had a deal with the Three County Fair where veterans got to go in free. But they go in there with their families. And what happens is you have the wife, you have the girlfriend or boyfriend, you have the mom, the dad going, hey, what's this about veteran stuff? Get over here, Johnny. And now all of a sudden Johnny has to come over and find out about his benefits. That works a lot better than trying to drag everybody to a veteran specific thing. So the concert was along that same line, and it went pretty well. And we're gonna try to make it bigger next year. We're going after some grants as well. So we keep trying to do outreach. I just wanted to show, this is a guide about veterans benefits and all the different programs that are out there. It's for Western Massachusetts only. I was at a meeting out in Clinton, and I was at another meeting at Hanscom Air Base, and I had this book with me, and people around the state are like, this is great. We should have something like that out here. And I have sent the template to many different people around the state. But this comes from David Sullivan's office, the district attorney's office. He has it done. He has it printed. Soldier On provides a lot of the money to get it printed, but they do it. And this is the latest edition. We did one several years ago. It's all been updated. It's a blue book. It's also on PDF. You can get it off of the DA's website. But it has... if you're a veteran and you were looking for something, it's there. If you're a family member, if you get a hold of this book, almost everything is in there. So Western Massachusetts, we lead a lot in the world of outreach and innovation about getting benefits information to people. So I'm proud to be from Western Massachusetts. I'm proud of what we do. I'm on a bunch of state committees, and they're pretty jealous about what we do out here, so.
It's great.
I was just wondering, briefly, what's the status of the Veterans Homeless Initiative?
Oh, son of a gun. I must have left my car. We had the point in time count that happens every January. This time it was January 23rd, I believe, where they actually go outside and count. And Hampshire County, we had three veterans that were unsheltered. In the three county COC, there was three veterans outside on a very, very cold night. One is in Northampton, one was in Franklin County, and one was in Berkshire County. And then there was all those that are sheltered. That means those that are at the cop shelter, Grove Street, or at Soldier On. We count all those folks. The number's down big from last year because Soldier On just opened up two big housing units. So you had 44 units up in Leeds, and 42 of them or 45 opened up in Chicopee. So their numbers went way down for a little while. So our numbers are down. People are still falling into it. The economy is still suspect, but we have, I had convinced the mayor a few years ago to make the pledge that we were gonna end veterans homelessness. Doesn't mean that you've ended it completely, it just means you've come up with a system that if a veteran comes into my door, down to Gary Howe in employment and training, into the courts, wherever it might be, or just going to the VA or Soldier On, that somebody is going to assess them and make a housing offer within the first 30 days. They're gonna come up with a housing plan, and the idea is by 90 days, that person on average should have been housed into permanent housing. There are some caveats, and those are those that desire more treatment. Those that have been incarcerated and it's part of their release and things like that. So there's some things about it. But we have a system now in place. We can essentially announce, except the data is very difficult to get a hold of to show Washington, D.C. I probably can get it all done in the next 3 weeks if we stop getting blizzards and I can meet with a few people. But we have pretty much the data to prove that we've done what, but I just can't announce until it gets clear through Washington.
And then are you, in theory, entitled to assistance from the federal government, federal program?
Well, what it does is just recognizes that so far in the state of Massachusetts, only one community has done it, and that was the city of Lynn.
Really?
Right. Holyoke hasn't gotten it approved or whatever, because of the system they don't have in place.
Okay.
But their numbers, there is only one outside homeless and they've been contacted and stuff. We're different because we have the homeless shelter, so our numbers show hundreds because everybody in the homeless shelter counts on that count, in the homeless count.
What does the actual point and count that you refer to?
Point in time count?
Sorry.
It's done by a lot of different people.
Point
in time count. And it's done by the COCs. So about 5 years ago it changed that the three county COC is now Berkshire, Franklin, and Hampshire County. The participants of that, and I'm one of them, our office is one of them, are the ones who do that count. And it's basically going to the shelters and it's walking around the streets. We have one veteran outside, knew he was outside, he was easy to count. There was nobody down at the river, which was good on that cold, cold night, but the people that were in the cot shelter, they all get counted. People at Grove Street get counted. People over at Craig's place, you know, they're all
right.
in the count, and veterans are amongst them and they get counted that way. And it's done by, you know, there are people out in the street. Brendan from Elliott Homeless Services usually covers Northampton and goes over and helps in Hadley and Amherst.
Okay.
There's people in it.
What an enormous job.
Yeah.
Just to
and this year, instead of going out on the streets, I had gotten called to Boston.
Okay.
And then I was going to participate out in Boston, but they said, nah, we got plenty of people. I said, okay. But you go out, talk to them, ask them a few questions, try to find out what's going on, and then list them. So the youth was a focus this year, veterans are a focus, and the chronically homeless are a focus. And we got original data in.
It's to your enormous credit that you've set up that system and are implementing it
successfully. Yeah, if I had known it was gonna be
that's great.
As crazy as it was, I probably wouldn't have said, oh, come on, Mayor! But I'm glad we did it.
Yeah.
It's just, it's a struggle, but once the system's in place,
right.
You know, anybody can step in and take over from me and it'll just keep going. Or any other agency when it comes to veterans. If they've got a history of military service, one of these three things is gonna help them either get housed or stay housed.
That's important. I'm not sure people know that, because they might have heard that we set a goal.
Right.
But that's not just, we set a numerical goal and we're going to do whatever we can. You actually have set up a system.
Right.
You may not ever get to zero, or you may be some years zero and some years not, but you have a procedure in place.
Yeah, and the other thing, one of the parts that really was important in a change is we do a by name list. We use the person's first name and last initial to identify them rather than just a number.
Okay.
What's important is, I remember the first year in 2009, I was on the Governor's Council to prevent veterans homelessness. After working on it for a year, the following year, the numbers went up. And it was like, wait a second, how can the numbers go up? I think that year I'd already housed like 60 something veterans right out of this office. And I was like,
yeah.
But you house one, somebody else is falling in.
Uh-huh.
And it's also a very transient population. They're homeless.
Uh-huh.
So I know there's a struggle over in Amherst where, you know, the Amherst residents were like, okay, you're going to have a homeless shelter for those Amherst residents that are homeless. Well, no, they're not Amherst residents. They're homeless. They come from everywhere. So if you build it, they will come,
because
that's where they're going to get the help.
Right.
So Amherst has people from all over Western Massachusetts,
right.
Connecticut, whatever, because they're homeless. It's wherever they...
Right.
Wherever they can get shelter and get support services. Same thing happens here.
I didn't know Craigslist was on the chopping block, and I think that was a 9C cut that was reversed,
yep.
Actually.
Yes, it was reversed. That was a lot of pushing from a lot of us to make sure that didn't happen.
That's good.
Yeah. And, you know, more and more communities are going to have to step up and do this because, you know, you have somebody down in Hamden County. Well, right now you got only a couple few places to go, and if they're full, you come up here. You go wherever you can get the services.
I see.
So when somebody says, well, I just want it for the residents of my community, you
doesn't
can't
work
do
like
that.
That.
No. Homeless is homeless.
Right.
You can't say, well, I used to live on that. Well, my grandfather lived out here. You know, I mean, it's whatever it takes. So we work really well. The cooperation that goes on between all the homeless providers, including the VA and Veteran Services in Western Massachusetts, is an example of how it works. And the rest of the state is like, wow, how do you do that? I'm also in housing court every Monday morning, I or a representative of my office, for any veteran who might, or their spouse who might be like at risk. They go in because they're behind on their rent. I have programs to help them out, connect them up. So that's one thing we do. I also do the round table up at the jail.
Mm-hmm.
When veterans are 30 days or less to getting out, where are they going?
Right.
Are they going to soldier on? Okay, well, we're gonna see you there. We've got this program for you there.
Right.
You're going to live with your brother, your sister, your mother, your whatever, your wife,
yeah.
Or ex-wife. Some of them live with their ex-wives on the couch. We connect with them and find out where they're going to go. We want them stable. We want to get them on benefits, get them hooked up with jobs and all of that kind of stuff. So it's all of preventing homelessness is job stuff. It's utility arrearages. It's all the things. And we just keep trying to go to everywhere to make sure. We just set it up to happen at the Hamden County Jail. It's not me, but other people who hold my office are going to be down there.
Mm-hmm.
Just like they have here in Hampshire County, and statewide they're going, you guys have a round table? I'm like, yeah, Sheriff Garvey started it many years ago, and they're like, wow. So they're trying to replicate that around the state.
I'm so surprised that other,
yeah,
that Hamden County doesn't have it.
Right, they're just now doing it. I mean, they're a bigger facility, so it's harder for them than it is for Hampshire, but now they're gonna have one just for veterans, so.
Well, thank you, I don't wanna go on and on.
Oh,
it's interesting, and thank you for doing it.
Yeah, sorry, I do.
Oh, no. I'm curious about how in Leeds, the 44 beds?
Yes, they built 44 units.
Did they fill up pretty quickly?
Oh, gosh, yeah. There's a waiting list.
Yeah. And where did they all come from? How many local, how many from?
Well, again, it's the people, most of them had come through the Soldier On program.
Mm-hmm.
So they could have come from Springfield, Holyoke, Northampton. I mean, I know Northampton veterans that I had on for a long time trying to find them jobs, they just couldn't, didn't find them. They ended up going on disability. You don't get a lot on disability depending on, you know, what jobs you had before. So there were some of the ones that have moved into those apartments. Mm-hmm. And if you didn't get a chance to go up and see them, they're amazing.
Yeah,
you know, single, double level, you know, really nice. They have about, when they moved in, they get $2,000 they put into the apartment. And so they're limited equity. So say they want to leave, that $2,000, whatever interest was made off of that real estate, off of that property to the next one, that veteran can take it, go to the next place if they are moving on and up. But for the most part, those apartments were really intended for the chronically homeless veterans that have been from shelter to shelter for decades and are medically fragile. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, there's already been a few that have passed away while they've been up there. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the VASH program. We've moved them into apartments and 6-7 months later, they pass because it's a hard, hard life. The average age for somebody who's been chronically homeless as a veteran is the age of 63. And we have many of them in their late 50s and 60s who, you know, you finally get them housed and then they kind of go, but then health issues come. And so that's why there's such a push, and we are also part of that push of young people. If they're homeless, we're getting them stabilized as fast as possible, getting them vouchers, getting them services, so that, you know, they might be homeless for 2 years rather than 15, 20, 25 years, because that does a job on the body.
Yeah. Steve, I don't see too many signs anymore, like down on Main Street, homeless veterans. Remember?
Oh, yeah.
And our Veterans Committee, that you were going down Main Street, mm-hmm. talking to some of the individuals, and you actually found out that, and you forewarned us counselors on our committee of that they were not veterans.
Yeah, many of them were not. The ones that were, if they really didn't know about us, we made sure they got connected. But I would say over the last 6-7 years, I think I've found 2 veterans out of all of that population. But my staff, some like to get coffee down there, some like to get coffee down there, some like to get pizza over there. And as they walk the street, if they have a sign that says they're a veteran, they just drop off my card and say, come and see me. Or they'll ask, oh, where did you serve? And then they'll come back and say, no, not a veteran. And I can actually encourage them to stop doing that because of a law that was passed under Valor Act 2, Stolen Valor. If you pretend that you served and you're a combat vet and you really aren't, you could be fined or jailed.
So
that gave us a tool.
Stolen Valor Act.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So if you wear medals, if you say you did these things and you didn't, and I've had a couple guys come through housing court. They were still eligible. I was still able to help them, but you know, they were talking to one of my guys, and he was like, "Yeah, you know, oh yeah, I served in Iraq, and I was in this," and he goes, "Hate to tell you, but I was in that unit, and I've never seen you my whole life, and I was there at the same time." And the guy's like, "Oh, okay." And then we found out he never went over, but you know, he could have gone to jail for that. We got him help and got him services, but.
But you can really see there's a significant difference.
Yeah, they're down. They're down because my staff really makes sure. Because I don't want to go out and say, we've ended veterans' homelessness, and then there's somebody holding a sign saying, I'm a veteran. We can provide services. They don't have to be homeless. We have one gentleman who is waiting for God to tell him when to move in, but he's outside because we can't. It's mental health. We just can't get him in. I try all the time.
He's out on the streets all the time?
Yeah, he's been outside. This was his 8th winter outside. He doesn't even go into the cot. And he's lived. He went to the hospital twice this winter. But I can't get him to go in. And I ask all the time.
Why doesn't he want any help?
It's something with his church and with a minister. And It's a mental health. He has real issues, but...
And no tent or nothing?
No. No, but he's got some warm clothes.
Oh, my goodness.
But we keep trying. For a while, it was, I was supposed to ask every 2 weeks, the mayor's challenge has this criteria, and it says you gotta ask every 2 weeks. Well, he was starting to, it took me a long time to get to talk to him again. And then I was starting to do it, and then he was like, how many times you gonna, yeah, I was getting upset. So then I said, all right, what'll happen is I'll drive by, if I see you in front of the church, I'll just thumbs up, thumbs down, you tell me. And, you know, and he'd give me the thumbs down. Well, that worked for about a month and a half. Then it was like, somebody from the church says, he's really getting annoyed with it. And I said, you know what? I don't want to make him not want to come to me. So just gently ask him whatever. And I even saw him down at the veterans lunch we have. And I said, you know, look, when you're ready, just come to me. I can get you housed. You know, it won't be perfect, but it'll get you out of the elements. Mm-hmm. I hear you, Mr. Conner, but he still hasn't come in.
I'm worried about it, yes.
Just the other thing that you folks should know that Northampton is kind of on the forefront with. The Episcopal Church, the Archdiocese of the Episcopal Church of Western Massachusetts came to me 2 years and 3 months ago. It was like November of that year. And they're the ones who run Cathedral in the Night in front of First Church. And they wanted to do something for veterans, and they wanted to, and they said, what if we do like a veterans lunch? But we don't want to do it at the church because, you know, we're not trying to preach. We just want them to be comfortable and veterans just to kind of connect. And after negotiating and talking, I'm also the president down at the World War II Club, so that made it a little easier. Why don't we have it down there? And 2 years ago, the first Wednesday of February, we started that veterans lunch. Of course, the first week, we had one veteran show up. Second week, same veteran showed up, but I didn't show up. I forgot about it, and I didn't make lunch. On the third Wednesday of that month, he came back. And on the fourth Wednesday of that, of February, four veterans came in that day. And now there's anywhere from 50 to 70 veterans show up every single Wednesday for the lunch down there. It's a free lunch for veterans. And sometimes somebody comes in and talks to them about different things, history project, things like that. But now that exists in Greenfield on Thursdays, Holyoke on Thursdays, and in Springfield. So we started it 2 years ago, and it's going great. We have veterans with money and retirement who just want to shoot the, you know, chew the fat. And we have some of the veterans who are homeless go in there, and they all go and have lunch together. So it's pretty cool. It's a great experience. And Northampton was the first one to do it. It's worked well.
Perfect. Yes, I know.
So I can shut up now.
Anybody else have any other questions?
I think I answered all of them.
Well, thank you for a very thorough presentation.
Thanks for your excellent work. Really impressive.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, after 13 years, I'm getting the hang of it.
What have you done before you moved into this?
I used to work, I was a community educator and worked with school systems with young men with autism. And when they were at transitional age, I was getting them into the community. I was getting them into the community at school. That was my job for a few years. And then Mayor Higgins asked me if I wanted to do this, and I went, why would I want to do that? But in retrospect, I'm really glad I did it, because it's been a rewarding career. That's and great. The city council, I mean, I grew up in this town, but I love it because, you know, I have people go, oh, the People's Republic of Northampton, or you know, all the liberals, and they're like, oh, they hate veterans. And I'm like, no, 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 no. I said, don't get confused about a community that doesn't like war. But I said, you find me a community that does a better job of taking care of their veterans.
You got it.
Then you can say something. But I said, I don't think you can find one in the state.
Huh.
You can hear people do lip service with ceremonies.
Mm-hmm.
I remember way back when I actually helped the National Guard. They have the what's called the Yellow Ribbon group that goes and for when veterans are coming home from deployment and getting them services, reintegrating them, getting them talked to. Well, there was a lieutenant colonel, and I had worked with him in my early years, and we came up with a covenant to have community sign covenants to say, we're going to take care of our veterans, right? Well, there was, you know, Northampton needs to do it. Well, the mayor of Northampton at the time said, aren't we already doing it? We don't need to announce it. And I went, no, you don't. Well, a community that's a little south of us here, they did sign that covenant. They made a big deal about it. And then when Soldier On went to move down there, they're going, you're going to put up a fence around that, aren't you? And then they also didn't want to pay 115 benefits to anybody who lived there. And I went, that's the difference between announcing you signed some covenant and actually serving veterans. And that's the difference between Northampton and some other communities in Massachusetts, in my humble opinion.
Question before you leave.
Yeah.
The C-54 Memorial on Florence Road.
Yes.
How far are we with this? Because I know that we have one of the attorneys in Northampton looking at it, and George Adams had passed away.
Mm-hmm.
So what is going on with this?
As far as who possesses it, who has ownership of it, the Adams are basically, look, the city, you guys just take care of it. We're not going to care that it's on, some of it's on our property, some of it's not.
It's not on our property. It was given, my husband surveyed that.
Right, well, the flagpole, there's
oh, the
all
flagpole
that.
The flagpole part, yeah, is worthy.
There's all kinds of different things. But what has been, I've had many civic groups who sit there and say, oh, we can take care of it. I even had a landscaping company who said, oh, I'd love to take care of it. I'm like, great, I don't have time. I can't just pick up and go with a shovel and stuff like that. But every time when that's happened, the ball's been dropped. It lasts for one season, and then I don't hear from them again. But I did talk with Smith Volk. They're not going to make it their project.
Oh, good.
So until Smith School closes, I got a crew, that landscaping crew, and they're actually making plans on how to redesign it and make it more easy to take care of and how to improve it. So they're designing that, and if you're interested, I'll show you what the plans are when they come
in. I would like to see that.
Yeah, and they're gonna just make it an easier care kind of place.
We invested $75,000 on fundraising to put that up.
Yeah, yeah. So it because of the terrain and some of the bushes hadn't worked, some of the stuff didn't work, so they're gonna redo it and take care of it. And they're also talking about doing the same in front of Memorial Hall.
Oh, good. Thank you.
And those
are
a lot of work.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to me, folks.
Thanks so much.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. We will move on to the two appointments that were referred to us on February 2nd. And I believe Councilor LaBarge spoke with Deborah Epstein.
Deborah Epstein.
Yep.
Yes. Thank you. I had a lengthy talk with Deborah on the phone, a good hour, probably an hour and 20, 25 minutes. And Deborah lives on my ward, and she was very interesting to talk with. And everything that she's stating in her little resume type that she's put in here is exactly what we talked about. She has a vision of, because of her being a consultant and so forth, and working at Bay State Medical, working at Cooley Dixon Hospital with Jeff Harness and so forth, she deals with people and seniors or whatever. And that is why she really wants to be on the Senior Center Services Board, is because of what her vision is of reaching out to different diversities. And I've always said that, you know, we needed a more diversity at the Senior Center. And that's what she's looking at doing. And if you read what she's saying, is what she told me on the phone also. She believes that, in her recommendation, she would like to get and have involved more of of people that are 55, 59 years old to be involved at the senior center. And I think that's a good thing to do, because the older ones, they get really old and they can't come down there anymore, and start bringing in the 55s, 59ers, and they're getting involved in activities and so forth like that. And it's there, it is happening. We've got people right here in the city now. We have more people in their late 50s that are going down there, that I do know. And she wants to promote, you know, healthy aging, because that's what she deals with. And she also, she's saying that I'm invested in aiding the city of Northampton in attracting citizens to the center so that they will feel comfortable and familiar with the center. And that, I told her, made me happy, because 2 years ago we did have somebody who came to us when we were doing the CDBG interviewing in regards from an agency, which question was asked, well, do you bring your seniors? And they said, we have, but they felt uncomfortable. Well, naturally, when you're a different diversity, you can't speak English, that's a problem. So she really wants to move forward on that and reach out to the people. And probably we can get Casa Latina to be involved again, like we try to get them involved. And I actually got somebody on the board from who was of Latino at the senior center. So it's opening the doors. She has really some great plans to do. And she said that she had talked with Linda last fall and told Linda exactly what she felt about bringing in more people, more activities. And I like her ideas. I like her vision. And she said if Linda ever decided to leave, that she would put in for director. That's what she told me, because she's really interested in working with seniors. So I like what she had said to me.
Is that a motion for a positive?
I make a motion for a positive.
And yep. Second, okay. Any more discussion? All those in favor of Deborah Epstein as a positive recommendation to the full council?
Aye.
None opposed? One passes. And Councilor Bidwell? Spoke with Pauline folks?
Yes, I spoke with Pauline. She's been on the historic commission for, actually, I'm not sure how long, but she's very much looking forward to being reappointed. She brings a realtor's experience, which is helpful to have on that body. And in particular, she's helpful to understand, for example, that if there were to be an increase in the restrictions within the Elm Street Historic District, she's convinced from her experience in the market that it would not impact one bit the market value of those, or the market appeal of those. It's her experience that there's such an attractive place to live that there are plenty of folks who would be quite content to continue investing in properties, even with somewhat more enhanced historic restrictions. So she brings that kind of perspective to the commission. I would absolutely recommend a positive recommendation for Pauline.
Is there a second? Any more discussion on Pauline? Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
And no opposition, so that one goes with a positive recommendation. We had a number of others that were referred on March 2nd, but we're not going to take them up until April 10th.
Councilor Carney, I did put them on the agenda for Thursday, so if anybody's prepared to discuss them, they can move forward.
Oh, okay, because I don't think
I did.
Okay, so before we move on to them, we know that, would you be interested in speaking with Nora Muhammad?
Happy to, yes.
See right on the back side of your agenda. That's the appointment to Human Rights Commission replacing Natalia Lundgren.
Happy to do that.
Thank you. All right, and then we had the Housing Partnership. And I don't think you've spoken to Kyla yet, right?
I thought I was doing, because I asked you at City Council.
Oh, I'm sorry, and you were doing the Two Arts Council.
I said the Two Arts Council, and no, I had not.
Okay, so Pam, so that means at least three we won't have ready for...
That's fine.
Unless I touch base with them now, Thursday. Well, except we wouldn't come back here.
They don't have to all go together.
Yeah, okay, if you want to take this other one, this other Kyla, and take care of her on Thursday, we can do that because Mary Ann's already spoken with her.
I did.
So why don't we...
Because Pam told me it was on the agenda, so you go ahead and interview.
Okay.
Okay. So anyways, I reached Kyla, and she's very, very interesting. And she is saying, I want to be on the Housing Partnership because I've worked with many children and young adults that have struggled with housing security. Their struggles with housing security have affected their stability, which impacts their education and their long-term success. By providing stable housing for youth, families, and all that needed, we could eliminate one, the many barriers that makes it challenging for people to live happy, successful lives. I'm especially interested in the Northampton Housing Partnership because I took urban politics with Martha Ack Ellsberg while I was at Smith. As part of a final project of that course, I spoke with some local managers and owners of Section 8 housing and developed a report that included the historical nature of housing segregation and the long-term disadvantages that have affected Tennessee options. And then she says, as a former teacher, I bring an ability to work with others to address groups of people, to provide training, and modify complex concepts into simple objectives that folks can walk away feeling that they have mastered. And she feels that she also will bring an understanding on how housing and housing insecurity can impact so many facets of life for many people. And she thanks us very much for considering her to get on the board. So I make that recommendation.
Okay, that's a motion for a positive recommendation to council. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, any more discussion on Kyla? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And that motion passes. So we will, I guess when we come up with these on the consent agenda, we'll have to take them out of the consent agenda and then have them postponed until the following meeting. Mm-hmm. We still have time, I'm assuming.
Yeah.
Okay. So then we'll take up these three at our next meeting in April,
okay.
Which takes us to the next item on the agenda. The mayor said that he would come to our April meeting.
Good.
And we've asked him to talk about the appointment process. And we'll take up these other three appointments. Mm-hmm. And then in May, we have the opioid crisis focused meeting with fire rescue, police, and the health department.
Great.
Okay.
So that I can start, notifying the mayor's office about the May discussion. Have you already had a talk with them, Councilor Carney, or no?
No.
Okay.
No.
So we definitely want to plan and move forward with that, right,
members? Want to move forward with that, with the May opioid crisis in the city?
Okay, so I think...
we have to see if police, fire, and health can come.
Yeah, so I think it would be helpful, between now and the next meeting, if people can get a list of questions together that they want, or...
Could people forward those to Pam if you...
That would be great.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay.
I have a question about this May appointment. and the different departments, because being on the Citizens Advisory Board with the District Attorney's Office, they work with the city also, so I'm just wondering if there was a possibility that we could invite the District Attorney to be involved in the roundtable.
It sounds like a good idea. I think a lot of the efforts are regional and go through the DA's office.
I don't know.
Work with them too.
I don't know who over there would be the person, Mary Carey.
Yeah, I think one of their community outreach people might be potentially a good choice.
Mary Carey is outreach, and Lori Lizelle also.
Do you want me to extend the invitation?
Yes, please. Yeah, okay. That would be great. Mm-hmm.
Good idea.
Okay. Is there any new business? Then I'll ask for a motion.
I would make such a motion.
Second.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.